Yeah.
Okay. Clap. Okay. So what we're going to do this afternoon is to discuss connectivity analysis. And I've already mentioned before that one of the reasons why we're recording EEG and MEG is because it offers a very high temporal resolution. And this a very high temporal resolution allows us to identify when something is happening in the brain. It also allows us to identify part of the mechanisms by which it is happening. For example, whether it's event-related, an evoked locked component, or whether oscillatory components in the brain activity are different, thereby possibly identifying interaction between networks. But of course, EEG and MEG data also have a very high temporal resolution, which allows us to look at the precise timing and the timing relationship between brain areas. And that's basically what we use connectivity analysis for. Let me start with the different metrics that we have for computing connectivity analysis. So what we have is we have data, which is recorded using MEG channels over the head, and we have multiple sources. So what we can do is we can look at a network of this source connected to this source connected to that one, this and that one, and for example, a visual source that is projecting towards motor cortex to frontal brain region. So if a visual stimulus comes on, then visual cortex detects the signal. It informs frontal cortex and it informs motor cortex, and frontal cortex informs motor cortex, and motor cortex makes a response. And that actually also allows us to study connectivity within the brain, connectivity within the central nervous system, at a scale which is larger than the brain. So rather than only studying it between different sites within the brain, we can actually use the muscle output, because the alpha motor neuron in the spinal cord projects directly onto the muscle fibers. That means that if we record EMG over the muscle, we can actually also probe part of this network. And that's what we started off with in NatMEG, studying cortical muscular coherence. Because if you do cortical muscular coherence, you can do recordings from two sites that are really far away, which means that you don't have to worry so much about volume connection. So we can compute connectivity between motor regions and sensory regions, for example. And we have many ways of computing connectivity. And in general, they can be split up over two families. We have effective connectivity and we have functional connectivity. In effective connectivity, you really try to make a model of how one brain region, how the activity in one brain region is causing or influences the activity in another. Whereas functional connectivity is more correlational in nature. So the time series of one brain region is correlated with the other, but on the basis of correlation by itself, you cannot infer causality. Then we have another dimension among which we can split connectivity measures. So we have either more model-based, or we make an explicit model and then we fit the model to the data, or we have more data-driven approaches for doing connectivity analysis. And then we also have another dimension that we can consider in connectivity analysis, where we can look at connectivity in a time domain. We can also look at connectivity in a frequency domain. So there's multiple axes that you can consider in deciding which connectivity measures you want to use. We can also use linear measures. We can use nonlinear measures. And the consequence of having all these different axes that you want to consider in designing a connectivity measure and in designing connectivity analysis is that there's a lot of different methods available. Field trip is specifically good at these types of measures. So we do a lot of functional connectivity using linear measures that are data-driven and mainly in the frequency domain. There are so many methods out there that it's impossible to implement all of them, but there's other software toolboxes available that also implement more model-based measures of connectivity, such as dynamic causal modeling, or that are more focused on effective connectivity or at nonlinear measures. Okay, I already said we have a lot of them. We have a lot of connectivity measures. We have coherence, we have phase locking, phase synchronization, synchronization likelihood. It's a whole zoo of measures of connectivity analysis. And that's kind of challenging, because like you don't know which one is the right one for you to use. Actually, I also don't know which one is the right one for you to use. So what I'm not going to do today is to explain the difference between all of these different connectivity measures. What I'm going to do is I'm going to try to give you an understanding of how these connectivity meshes work in general by picking two of them and explaining them in great detail. A lot of different methods have been devised to deal with specific problems in the data, such as volume conduction. A lot of them are actually relatively comparable, but they differ in the details. But I think it's most important that you get the concept of connectivity analysis, and for that I'm going to do two. So let's first recapitulate what constitutes an oscillation. So this is what I showed yesterday. We have an oscillatory brain activity, which has a period, it has an amplitude, and it has phase. And I already showed yesterday that we can plot the phase in a complex plane. So we can plot the contribution of the sine and the cosine component with the cosine component along the horizontal axis and the sine component along the vertical axis. And this is the complex representation of an oscillation, because we call the horizontal axis, we also call it the real axis, and the vertical axis the imaginary axis. If we take this complex notation, and what we have is we have that's done with with exponentials. We have a times e to the power I phi. So there's two important parts here. We have a, which is the amplitude, and we have phi, which is the phase. And if we then plot the activity at a specific oscillation, we have a certain length, which is expressed by a. We have the phi, which is the angle, right? So what now if we consider two oscillations? So let's look at the phase difference between two oscillations. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to show this movie. So what I have here, I have one oscillation, and I can plot the oscillation in the time domain, but I can also plot the oscillation in the complex plane. So let me start it once more. So what you see happening is that at this particular point, just moving up and down, and it basically constitutes like here rotating it around. So that's one oscillation. So what you also will have noticed is I have a second oscillation here. So basically what I have here is two channels, two time series, and I have the phase and the amplitude expressed here, and I can look at the phase difference. So let me start it once more, and I'm going to look at the phase difference. So what you see is that the phase difference between the two signals, because they're both rotating, but the phase difference is very inconsistent. So it's basically the phase difference ranges over a very large angle. And if the phase difference is very inconsistent, then we consider these two oscillations to not be in synchrony. So phase difference is scattered, and that means it's a very low synchrony. Whereas if I now look at a two time series which have a much tighter phase difference, so basically they're both more or less running at the same speed, and the phase difference doesn't change too much, like it changes a little bit. So what you now see is that the phase difference is scattered over a much more narrow range. It means that the phase difference is high, or it's clustered, and we considered it as a token of high synchronicity. Yeah? So how do we quantify this synchronicity? So if we look at the complex valued representation of signal x1, it is a1 times e to the power I phi. We have the same one for x2. And what we can do is we can compute the complex conjugate multiplication between the two. And computing the complex conjugate multiplication, which is done here, gives me this number. And this number constitutes the amplitude of signal 1, the amplitude of signal 2, and the phase difference. Yeah? So what I'm doing is I'm basically computing this arrow. And if this arrow is not scattered over time, it's a synchronous measure. And this is basically what we use, actually. So this measure is the cross spectrum, which we've been using this morning to compute the beamform and source reconstructions. But this measure is also used for computing synchrony. coherence is one of these measures of synchrony. It's a very popular method. It has been used a lot, although it has its issues. It's one of the methods that you really should try to understand. So coherence is computed from the cross-spectral density, which is obtained by conjugate multiplication of the frequency domain representation of the two signals, so which you actually have computed this morning. So this is the complex conjugate multiplication. And what we do with coherence is that we average this signal, sorry, we average this representation, which is has an amplitude, A1 times A2, and it has a phase, e to the power I phi 1 minus phi 2. And we compute it for each of the trials that we have in the data, for each of the data segments. And what we subsequently do is that we average over all of these different trials, and that gives us an averaged cross-spectral density. If the phase over the trials of the phase difference over the trials, sorry. If that is consistent, I'm going to get an arrow here with a considerable length. Whereas if I have over my multiple observations of the data, trials or data segments, if you have a phase difference which is like pointing in different directions, then the average is going to be small. This is a single trial cross spectral density. And so what we do is we sum and normalize single trial cross spectral densities. Coherence is the sum of the single trial cross-spectral densities divided by the length of the two arrows. We have a similar measure which is called phase locking value. And phase locking value is very similar, except that here, rather than taking the amplitude into account, in phase locking value we don't take the amplitude into account. So we basically say, well, we ignore the amplitude, we only look at phase consistency. So it's a very similar measure, it has slightly different characteristics. So basically phase locking value is just the length of this arrow. Whereas coherence is also sensitive to the correlation of the amplitudes. So this is coherence. And what you can see, what you might have noticed, is that we take the absolute value of this number. And this number is a number, so the coherence is a number between 0 and 1. If the number is 1, then we have a very high coherence. We have the phase is always the same. If the number is 0, then it's going to be very small. It's also interesting to consider it without taking the absolute value, so because that allows us to express it in such a way where we have the strength of the coherency, which is the coherence, but where we also have the phase of the coherency. And looking at the phase of the coherency, we can see whether one signal is consistently oscillating before the other signal. Right, so this is, again, it's the complex valued representation of this number, where we have phase and where we have the length of the arrow as the amplitude. One of the things that we have as a problem with assessing coherence is common pickup. So if we have two electrodes at a scalp, these two electrodes are going to show, are going to see the same source, which means that if a single source is going to cause phase consistency of between two channels, even though there are no other sources present. And one of the methods that has been suggested to deal with common pickup from one source on multiple channels is to not look at this value by itself, but only to look at the imaginary component of the phase. The imaginary component of the coherence. If we look at the imaginary coherence, what we're doing is we're effectively, we're looking at that part of the signal which is 90 degrees out of phase. So every time that's the phase consistency between two signals, but only for the 90 degrees out of phase components. That means that if there is a single source underneath the two channels, that source will have an imaginary coherence that is zero, because the source is picked up simultaneously by both channels. So the source will have a coherency with a phase that is along the real valued axis. Whereas if we have two sources that are synchronous but out of phase, they will project partially along the imaginary axis. So the imaginary part of coherency is a useful measure to remove common pickup and to remove volume conduction effects. But I will return to this later. But this is just what, like, already solving one of the first problems that we have with EEG and with MEG data, like common pickup, channel C, the same source. That's just something that we have to deal with. How can we look at coherence? Well, coherence is the coherence coefficient is very similar to a cross-correlation coefficient. And this morning I already explained, like, we have the cross-spectral density matrix and we have the covariance matrix. Covariance in time domain, cross-spectral density in the frequency domain. Well, from the covariance you can very easily compute the Pearson correlation coefficient. So actually, coherence squared is very similar to the Pearson correlation coefficient. It's the variance that is explained between the two signals. What you can think of is that coherence coefficient is very similar to frequency domain regression. Of course, there is a conceptual difference with regression, because with regression, what we always say, we have a variable x and we have a variable y, and y regresses on x. So we try to explain y given x. Whereas with coherence, what we basically have, we have two signals and they're interchangeable. The slope of the relative phase of, sorry, the we can estimate the phase of the coherence. And if we estimate the phase at multiple frequencies, we can look at the slope of the phase. And the slope of the phase spectrum indicates temporal precedence. So it means that if we compute the coherence spectrum, like not compute coherence for a single frequency, but if we compute coherence for a whole bunch of frequencies, we can look at the slope. And then the slope indicates whether one of the signals is constantly leading or lagging. If we look at a single frequency, and if we look at a single oscillation, you never know which one is leading and which one is lagging. Because basically, if this one's going up and this one's going down, which one is leading and which one's lagging? Well, they're in synchrony. But like, is 90 degrees in synchrony? Like, which one is leading, which one's lagging? It's just not clear. Whereas the slope of the coherency spectrum allows us to make an inference about the temporal shift of the two time series. However, the slope is often hard to estimate, or it's close to zero. So that's why it's not done a lot. But this is basically the phase slope index is one of these measures that is relying on estimating the slope of the coherency spectrum. Okay, so we've now have looked at one measure of connectivity, which is coherence. But coherence does not really give us a lot of insight into which brain region is leading and which brain region is lagging. So that's why we also are interested in other types of connectivity measures, which allow us to make inference on the causal structure between the activity in the different brain regions. And one of the most popular methods for making this causality inference is Granger causality. And the idea of Granger causality, there we go, back from the future into the past and then into the future again. And let me explain Granger causality as well. So what we have is we have a time series, and Granger causality, basically it uses autoregressive models. So what we do is we look at a point in a time series and we ask the question, can we explain that point in the future by looking at the past? So if we take the time series, so I just copied part of the time series over. What I can do is I can take the same time series, I'm going to shift it a little bit. And then I'm going to shift a little bit and shift it a little bit. So every time, what you see is that I'm shifting it a little bit towards the right and cutting it off. So this is the moment in time which was 4 samples ago, 3 samples ago, 2 samples ago, 1 sample ago. Now the question is, this is 1 sample ago, 2 samples ago, 3 samples ago, this is now. And the question is, if I look at the time series, 1, 2, 3 samples ago, and if I make a linear combination of these time series, am I able to explain this time series? And of course, that's something that I can do only for one data point, but of course, it's much more convenient to do it for all data points at once. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a linear combination of these three time series to see whether any linear combination is able to explain this time series. This is autoregressive modeling. And this is a third order autoregressive model, and has 3 parameters, 3 of these beta values, and these 3 parameters, they specify how far in the past I'm considering the data. So this is only for a single time series. And this is the autoregressive model that I'm making. So what I say is that x at a certain, the signal at a certain time, is the sum of the signal for x shifted a little bit in time. Is this clear? Okay. Let's now consider two signals in time. So we're going to do bivariate autoregressive modeling. For each of the two signals, I can make an autoregressive model. So I have signal x, which is explained from its own past. I have signal y, which is explained from its own past. But I can also start wondering, is like, if I look at signal x, rather than only looking at whether x can be explained from its own past, can I also explain part of signal x from the past of signal y? So what I'm doing is here, I'm inserting another term, which is basically very similar to this term, trying to explain signal x from the past of signal x itself and from the past of signal y. And of course, I'm doing the same thing for signal y. So is signal y, can that be explained by its own past and by the past of signal x? Range of causality consists of fitting this model and then looking at the error terms. So what we have is we have signal x. So signal x is explained by its past, but not all of signal x can be explained by its past. So there's part of the signal, which is a noise term or an error term or a model error term. And the question is, like, we have a certain amount of error here. A certain amount of signal x cannot be explained. We have a certain amount of error here. If the past of signal y is able to contribute to explaining signal x, then we expect this error to be smaller than this one. So that's what we're doing with range of causality. We're comparing these error terms. And the comparison that we're computing is this one. So we take the variance of this one. So this is a time series, right? Because we have this value for each time point. So we compute the variance of this time series. We compute the variance of this time series. We divide them, and we take the logarithm. And that is the range of causality from signal y towards signal x, like how signal y contributes to signal x. And of course, we can do the same thing for signal x towards signal y. So we can look at whether the past of signal x is explaining the future of signal y and vice versa. And the causality argument is here that if something that happened in the past is that if that's influencing the current status, then there is a causal relation. Like there's something causing in the current status. So we're using temporal precedence and temporal causation to argue that it's that there's connectivity, but also that the connectivity is from one to the other and not the other way around. There is an analogy between Granger and plane regression. So if we look at plane regression or plane general linear modeling, what we're also doing is we take the data, which is the sum of beta weights times a matrix with regressors. And that's also an error term. And what we do with regression is that we can include additional regressors. So if I'm going to split it into one set of regressors and another set of regressors, again, I can compare this error term versus this error term. And that's actually what we're doing in an ANOVA. Like in an ANOVA, we have multiple linear models for the two main effects. What we can do is we can test whether the two main effects, whether a significant portion of the data is explained by the regressors and whether there's an interaction. So that's what we're computing F values. So the F values that we compute in an ANOVA are very similar to the range of causality values that we're computing with the multivariate autoregressive model. So that just helps you to think about this because you're probably more familiar with F and you expect F values to be around 1 under the null hypothesis. Under the null hypothesis that the data is not really being explained by the model. And under the alternative hypothesis, the F values become larger because more of the variance is explained. So in the end, it is very similar to doing an ANOVA, to doing a general linear model, but only the inference is different. Because what we're doing here is we're interpreting the results in terms of causality. Causality, how the past of y is influencing x and how the past of x is influencing y. Is this clear? Good. What I now want to move on is having seen that we have like connectivity measures such as coherence, which do not inform you about directionality, and we have connectivity measures such as Granger causality, which do inform you about directionality, we also have to deal with some issues. And one of these very practical issues that we have with EEG, but also with MEG, is electromagnetic field spread. So if we have a source, that source is visible on all channels. It's not only this source, but it's also an external sources. And one of these sources that we see quite a lot in our EEG and MEG data is the heart. Like, the heart is a strong muscle, it's constantly active, and the heart signal is going to be picked up by these two channels as well. Which means that if we compute the connectivity between these two channels, we're going to find that there's a high coherence between them, because the signal from this source is going to be phase consistent between the two channels. But also, the signal from the heart is going to be phase consistent between the two channels. So measures such as coherence, but also Granger causality, are influenced and are inflated due to common pickup. I already mentioned that one way that we can try to deal with this is by not looking at the instantaneous contribution to the coherency, but only look at the imaginary part of the coherency, which is the out-of-phase contribution, because electromagnetic field spread or common pickup would be instantaneous. Like, both channels would see the same thing at the same time. So if we now look at a source, then that source is visible on this channel with a certain amount, and if I consider this in the frequency domain, I can plot this as an arrow. And also, it would also be visible on this channel. So what you can see here is that the arrow is a little bit longer, which indicates that the source is slightly more visible on this channel than it is on this channel. And what I can do is I can take these two complex representations of the Fourier spectrum at these two channels, and I can compute the complex conjugate multiple, and I get this one. And important here is that I have the length of the arrow, which is basically due to the length of the two amplitudes, but I also have the phase. And what I'm going to have is that whatever common pickup I have, the phase difference between this one and this one is always going to be zero. So that means that common pickup is always going to cause coherency with a phase difference of zero. That also means that the imaginary part of the coherence is going to be zero. And whenever I have an imaginary part of the coherence that is not zero, that means that it's not a single source that is being seen by two channels. So this is a technique that was suggested by Guido Nolte, and other techniques have been developed that follow the same rationale. So rather than trying to assess all the connectivity, we're only assessing the connectivity or only the coherence, which we can reliably interpret. So here I'm plotting two sources. Both sources project onto both channels. And what you see is that the contribution of this source to both channels is indicated with a thick red arrow, and the contribution of this source to both channels is indicated with a smaller orange arrow. So basically, we have linear superposition. So the activity that we see on the scalp level, on the channel level, is a linear sum of the individual contributions. So what we can do is we can look at the length of the corresponding arrow, but just adding the contribution of the different sources to each other. So what I have is I have the green arrow here and I have a green arrow here. And if I compute the cross-spectral, the complex conjugate multiplication of these two green arrows, what I'm going to get is a complex valued number that has a certain amount of projection along the imaginary axis. Okay, so it also means that we are throwing away a lot of the information by looking at the imaginary coherence. Because what I have here is I have two sources, and these two sources, assuming that these two sources are highly coherent with each other, highly synchronous with each other, they're partially phase synchronous with each other with zero phase lag, and they're partially synchronous with each other with a non-zero phase lag. And we're just ignoring the part along the real valued axis, which means that imaginary coherence is not seeing all of the synchrony. It's only seeing that part which we can reliably interpret. However, if we now look at MEG, then we can compute one of these measures. So this is the weighted phase lag index, which is an extension of imaginary coherence. And the weighted phase lag index for a channel that was selected here at the front, we can compute, given a channel somewhere here at the front, we can compute the weighted phase lag index with all the channels on the MEG helmet. And what it suggests is that there is a frontal occipital directed interaction. So that over here, it's basically frontal activity that projects onto the occipital activity where the phase lag index is strongly negative. However, if you look at the data that was used here in curating this simulation, it's only heartbeat. So what we did here is we simulated data with only heartbeat components in it. So this is the full time series. Zooming in, you see the heartbeat. So this is just real MEG data with an ICA decomposition. We selected the heartbeat components and we removed all the other components. And then we projected the heartbeat components back to the channel level. And what you see here is that a measure such as weighted phase lag index, but also imaginary coherence, is still sensitive to the heartbeats. The reason for this is that the heart is not a single source. So if you consider how the activity spreads over the heart, there's also connections within the heart, right? So that means that the heart is a more complex source, which is where one part of the heart is heart muscle tissue is connected with another part of the heart muscle tissue. So basically, you have these propagating waves of muscular activity over the heart, which means that there's a connectivity. And that's non-instantaneous connectivity. So that means that the artifactual components that we have in the MEG data are not necessarily fully cancelled out by looking at imaginary coherence. So here you see the spatial topography of the two heart components. So this is one of the heart components, this is the other heart component. And just by taking these two time series and multiplying these with these two components, we can reconstruct data, and that data has such a topography for the weighted phase lag index.
Is that directly a reflection of the magnetic field of the heart?
Yes. This is the. So what we see is that part of the heartbeat is mainly visible on these channels, and part of the heartbeat is visible on these channels. And one of the ways that the heart has been modeled is by considering it as a rotating dipole. So that part of the heartbeat basically produces a dipole pointing in this direction, and slightly later in the beat, the dipole rotates. So that also means that if I consider a rotating dipole, like a rotating equivalent current dipole, actually I don't have a single source. I have a single point at which the dipole is, but I have the dipole moment pointing in one direction at one moment, and another direction at the other moment. So yesterday we've already looked at how equivalent current dipole models, how you can think of them. And usually we think of a single equivalent current dipole as having basically three directions which the current can flow, which means that a single rotating equivalent current dipole already has three components in it. And if these three components are not phase synchronous, so if the dipole is not always going in the same direction, but if it's basically rotating, then that means that we're going to get imaginary coherence that is not zero. We're going to get out of phase synchronicity due to a single source. And that's usually not how we want to interpret the data. So that is why, rather than looking at channel level connectivity, it is much better to do the connectivity analysis on the source level. So here I'm showing a data matrix with a number of channels by a number of observations. And what we've shown this morning is that we have an inverse operator, for example, these beamformer spatial filters, with which we can, for the number of brain components, for the number of voxels that we want to estimate, and we can multiply the sensor level data with our spatial filters to get our source level data. And each row of the source level data is basically a time series of the activity at that source, which means that I can compute a connectivity estimate of one source with all the other sources. And that gives me a representation such as these. So rather than doing connectivity at a channel level, you really should consider doing it always on the source level. Because at the channel level, you have so many problems, and these problems are not accounted for by going to more complicated connectivity measures such as imaginary phase of the coherency. The imaginary part of the coherency. At the source level, we're not resolving all of the problems, but at least we're resolving some of the problems. So this morning I also explained spatial filtering. So what we're doing with spatial filtering with beamforming is that we're considering a region of interest and we're trying to make a spatial filter that is perfectly selective for that point in space. And we can also look at another point in space and compute a spatial filter. But in reality what we have is spatial filters that look like this. So although they have a unit gain at the location of interest and they have minimal variance output, they still pick up activity from other regions. So that means that the estimate of the activity that I'm going to get at this location will be affected by activity that is going on elsewhere. And the same applies to this source. Okay, so that's important, because what you now see is that at this source location, I'm not only estimating the activity of this region of interest, but I also have spatial leakage of this source. Because this profile is not zero here. We try to make it as small as possible, but it's not going to go exactly to zero. So that at the channel level, we have a lot of spatial leakage. Channels really pick up a lot of common activity. At the source level, we still have some spatial leakage. And that's because the spatial filters are not perfect. So if we had a true source activity, the estimated source activity looks more like this. And it also means that if we consider the time course of the source activity and compute the connectivity between the two time sources, that is going to be affected by the spatial leakage of noise. So let's consider we have this pattern where we have a source here. And if we consider where this source is connected to over space, it is connected with the tissue over here. But the estimated source connectivity that we're going to get looks like this. The source itself seems to be highly correlated with neighboring sources. That's because with MEG and with EEG, our spatial resolution is not so high. So if you take a source and if you just shift the source by 5 millimeters, you're going to get more or less the same time series. More importantly, however, is that it's very difficult to distinguish this blip from the pattern that we have due to the spatial leakage. So also at the source level, we're still confronted with spatial leakage and with a difficulty to interpret connectivity. So what we would usually try to do is we would try to estimate the source connectivity, and given an experimental contrast, we would see whether any of the connectivity at the source level is explained by the experimental manipulation. So we would look at the difference here rather than try to interpret the spatial distribution of the connectivity itself. However, if the two conditions have different noise characteristics, then of course what we're going to get is a connectivity profile that looks very different. So that means that also in the subtraction, we still are sensitive to noise. And it also means that if we actually don't have any true source connectivity, we're still going to get a connectivity pattern at the source level that shows blobs all over the place. Yeah? That's just because we have spatial leakage. So to conclude, connectivity analysis is really cool. But there's many measures on the market, like for instantaneous connectivity or causal connections. But the interpretation of the results really should be done with care. Like at the channel level, it's extremely difficult to have correct interpretation of channel level connectivity. It's not that it's impossible, but I think that a lot of the papers that we have out there showing channel level connectivity are making too strong claims about it being connectivity about brain regions. We have much better chances of giving a correct interpretation of connectivity at the source level, but also at the source level, you still have to be careful with the way that you're interpreting the data, because there's many confounding effects that affect connectivity at the source level, such as artifacts, such as difference in signal noise. And that's really because MEG we cannot make ideal spatial filters. We don't have the accuracy of having implanted electrodes in the brain where we can really record activity from isolated brain areas. We can only estimate the activity from the outside. Okay.
Yeah,
there's many simulation studies. A lot of these connectivity measures that have been introduced in methods papers where they show that with simulations that the connectivity measure outperforms all the other connectivity measures. And then another paper comes out and shows that that connectivity measure outperforms all the connectivity measures. And it's usually, if you look at these papers, each of these connectivity measures makes assumptions. And if you simulate the data in a way that is consistent with the assumptions, then the model is going to explain the data perfectly well. So if you look at the papers that introduce connectivity measures, usually where they differ in is how they simulate the data on which they show how they perform. So I would really take the comparison between connectivity measures, I would take that with a grain of salt. Because what you're going to get, you don't necessarily have a fair comparison between the connectivity measures. What you have is a comparison between different ways of creating simulated data. And since we don't know what the real underlying data is on which we want to apply the connectivity measure, we also don't really know which of the connectivity measures has the assumptions that are consistent with the data that we have recorded.
How about evaluating connectivity results in terms of other results, such as known anatomy? Is it difficult to evaluate connectivity results from other things you know about the brain, like networks or?
Of course, I could also have shown some. I know that tomorrow afternoon we will also have a lecture in which results from connectivity analysis will be shown. And so there have really been nice papers that show the results of connectivity analysis and also relate these not only to known anatomy but also to findings from other imaging modalities such as fMRI. So I think that's really useful to do that. Of course, whether that's always possible depends on the type of data that you have available and depends on the type of research question that you have.
Like there's not like a big general caveat there?
You can. It's really useful to think about connectivity in terms of like known anatomy. But I'm working together with a lot of people within the Human Connectome Project where we're studying connectivity and many different measures of connectivity in functional MRI data. Which one is it? This one? And we're recording MEG and DTI and high resolution anatomical MRI and high temporal resolution functional MRI all within the same subject. And the goal is also there to bring those together, to co-register them such that we can anatomically compare them. But of course, with EEG or with MEG, the connectivity pattern that we're getting, they depend on the experimental task. With DTI, the connectivity pattern that you get doesn't depend on what the brain is doing. So as such, there's a lot of connectivity patterns in DTI that you will not find in your specific EEG recording. And there's a lot of connectivity patterns that with DTI you might not be able to pick up, which we are able to pick up with EEG. For example, projections over multiple neuronal groups, which do not necessarily show up in these long fiber tracks that DTI is sensitive for. So I think it's very useful to do these comparisons, but I don't directly expect them to have identical results. I think we should use them as converging evidence.
When should we choose a correlation-based approach rather than a causality-based? What is the advantage of correlations?
The advantage of correlation is that it's at least an advantage of correlation that I consider. And that's also what Ali mentioned yesterday. It's simple. That means that we can understand it. We understand it much better. With a correlation-based approach such as coherence, I can explain to you why, in only one or two slides, I can explain to you why a feature such as the heartbeat is affecting coherence.
But isn't it simply a measure of coactivation?
Yes, but it's a simple measure, but it's also it's a simple measure that we can understand what the confounding factors are. With Granger, it's already much more difficult to consider what the effect of confounding factors are. So that's why I'm still more in favor for using simple methods where we can and only use more complicated methods where we need it. In Granger causality, there's some unusual aspects, for example, that have to do with signal to noise. Like, we know that we have regression to the mean. So if we record a lot of data points, we know that and we have a model, then we know that that those data points are going
depending
to regress
on the amount
to the mean. Variance that we have in the data, the regression to the mean is going to be larger or smaller. Right? Let me just quickly draw this to make this more clear. So if I have XY scatter plot, if I don't have too much variance, it regresses a little bit to the mean. If I have a lot of variance, it's going to regress to the mean. So that means that the parameters of my model are going to regress towards the mean or going to regress towards zero. And that effect is also affecting Granger causality. So if we have if we make such an autoregressive model, and if we consider how the autoregressive model of a single channel can be improved by having another model, okay, imagine that we have a common pickup. Imagine that this channel is recording part of the hard signal. And imagine that this channel is also recording part of the hard signal. But imagine that the first channel is recording it with a higher quality than the second channel. Then the future of channel, so this one is the high quality, this is the low quality, this is just the more noisy channel. So if that is the case, then the more noisy channel, the future of the more noisy channel can be predicted better by incorporating the clean recording of the hard signal or the clean recording of the artifact. So what we have is that Granger causality is confounded by signal to noise, by signal to noise of common pickup. And the consequence is that we're basically, what we're saying is, okay, so the past of one signal is better explained by the past of the other signal than by its own past. But that's what we have if we have a noisy channel. So that means that measures such as Granger causality, they're confounded by signal to noise. And I think the same applies also to dynamic causal modeling. I think all of these methods have certain problems associated with them. And like, I do not know all the problems of all the methods. I don't even know all the methods. So the problems that affect dynamic causal modeling, I know that dynamic causal modeling makes rather strong assumptions on the noise. I don't know whether those assumptions apply to your data set. But I think that is something that you should be concerned about, like whether the assumptions of dynamic causal modeling apply to your data set. And we know that in general, these assumptions are only approximations of what's happening in reality. So we always know that the models are going to be wrong. But the more complex the model, the more difficult it is to find why it's going wrong. And that's why I have a tendency to stick to simpler models where I can and only use the more complicated models where I need to. I think, that's not to say that DCM is not a nice method. Like, DCM is really cool. It's really a very nice model. But I think DCM has its own issues and is not necessarily like a general purpose tool.
Generally, how should one move from the more basic frequency analysis to connectivity? So, for example, my present case, I have a drug study, and we found mostly alpha reductions in parietal cortex and gamma increases in frontal cortex. Then if I want to move to coherence or any other measure, I have multiple electrodes and multiple frequencies. And how would you do it? You would only look at connectivity at the specific electrodes and frequencies which were statistically significant before, or could you try, because otherwise we end up trying everything with everything
this is a problem that I have not addressed, but like with connectivity measures, we're inflating the number of values that we can compute, because we can compute connectivity between all channel pairs, so between all sources, which means that we're computing a lot of numbers out of the data. And it also means that we have a very large multiple comparison problem if we want to do a statistical test. So that is the reason why I think it is wise to first try to identify, using a localizer, a functional localizer that helps you to localize in space or in time or in frequency, an effect that is of interest, and then only proceed with that effect on the in the subsequent analysis. And it's not because there's nothing outside of this localizer, but just because this localizer helps you to reduce the multiple comparison problem. So it's very similar to how we do like beamformer source reconstruction. If you know that you have that you can localize brain areas by using an experimental manipulation that is orthogonal or that is independent from your true interesting experimental manipulation, you should just use it. You should just exploit the knowledge that you can zoom in on interesting pieces of data. So here I would really recommend zooming in on interesting pieces of data and not try to compute connectivity between everything and everything. Of course, after having computed it for the region of interest, you can still, and after having done a valid statistical inference, you can still explore the rest of the data, which is different. But if you start with exploring all of your data, then you cannot. Then it's very difficult to make a correct statistical inference. I would also say, don't do it on the channel level. Like move to the source level. At the source level, the spatial leakage, the common pickup between sources, is much more reduced compared to the common pickup at the channel level. So you're at a much better position in interpreting the patterns of connectivity at the source level than you are at the channel level.
How bad would it be, because it's an EEG study and we don't have MRIs of the subjects, would you recommend moving in direction or it's not?
So you just do it to the best of your ability.
Yeah.
So if you don't have MRIs, then just use a template anatomical brain to make a template volume conduction model, which Filter provides. So in the template directories is a template EEG volume conduction model. That's already an improvement on doing it at the channel level. Yeah, it's very similar to the dipole fitting, and if you, like with dipole fitting, you're going to fit a dipole to the data. But the dipole is always going to fit. That doesn't mean that it's going to fit very well. But you're always going to fit a dipole. Like if your model is a dipole, well then the result is a dipole. If the model is 10 dipoles, then your result is 10 dipoles. And with DCM, you also have this problem. Like you're building a model, and you're going to fit it to the data. So the result is basically what you put in the model. And of course, DCM, dynamic coarse modeling, not only comes with the generative model and estimating the connectivity, it also comes with a Bayesian framework for comparing model evidence. So as such, there is a little bit better techniques available in SPM than we have in dipole fitting for comparing whether the dipole models, which of the dipole models is the best. But still, it's you're going to get out of your analysis what you put in terms of assumptions.
Try some methods like ICA to remove the
out signal. That's indeed a very common strategy that we use. That we use ICA to remove the artifacts. Sometimes that is sufficient. Sometimes it's sufficient to just do beamformer analysis because the beamformer in itself also suppresses hard artifacts. So quite often we don't look at the we don't do ICA, we would just use a beamformer to reconstruct the time series. But these connectivity measures, they're so sensitive. And it means that if there's a very small trace in a time series of two sources, which is phase synchronous, or which has a causal structure in it, like which has an autoregressive model structure in it, then these Granger causality measures or these coherence measures are going to pick it up. That's just because they're extremely sensitive. And they've been designed to be extremely sensitive. And that's why quite often we will indeed also at the channel level already try to reduce the artifacts before we move on to the source level. And before we any trick that you can use to try to get rid of confounding factors is I would use. So the reason for having multiple methods is that the methods have different assumptions. And in the data, we just have different features, or some of the features are best explored with one method, and other features are best explored with another method. So there is not a single method that always works well. If there were, then life would be very simple. I would be out of work. So it really depends on the type of activity. So I within the human connectome project, there's two measures that we're currently exploring. One measure is the correlation between the amplitude envelope of band-limited signals. And especially at the alpha band, if you compute band-limited power or band-limited amplitude at many locations in the brain, you look at the amplitude envelope, then what we see is that we can get long-range correlations that are very consistent with the networks that we also see in fMRI. So it seems as if, like our interpretation at this moment, or the interpretation of the people that have been working on this, is that these oscillatory components are very similar to what people see with Bolt, with fMRI Bolt. And it also means that if you look at the amplitude of the oscillations, you get very close to what you see with Bolt. And that might explain why with amplitude envelope correlations, we see very similar structures as we see in Bolt. And that's like in resting state MRI, we see the default mode network. And we see the ventral attention network. We see visual networks. So that's why I think that method is very useful for studying types of activity that we're also studying with Bolt. But if we have a more fine detailed model for the I'm already done. I'm just answering questions.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, just so
yeah,
don't worry.
Yeah, you got that.
So if you know which brain regions are involved, then you can also start investigating the more fine-grained temporal dynamics. But like looking at the amplitude envelope of alpha, you're throwing away a lot of information about the phase. And actually, we're going to treat in that case we're treating MEG and EEG data in the same way as we're treating Bolt. The only thing is that we can tell, well, it's an alpha network or it's a beta network, but we don't have the fine-grained temporal information anymore. Whereas if you know, for example, that there's a motor task or a visual motor task where visual cortex is activated first and then subsequently the subject is making a response, then you already have much more information and you can use more sophisticated connectivity analysis methods for finding out the visual motor network and for seeing how the interaction, how the bottom-up and the top-down interaction in the visual motor network is implemented. So we're also using those methods. Other questions? No? Okay.
Was it good? Yeah, good.
Excellent. Okay,
well, let's...